All right, you're all set.
Hey. So, good morning, everyone. I'm Dr. Logan Rath, and I'm here with my colleague, Dr. Kathy Olmsted, who will start our presentation.
Hi, everyone. My name is Kathy Olmsted, and I am from the College of Brockport. I am an associate professor of literacy. Logan and I have been partnering on this OER project, and we are so excited to share it with you. Our presentation is called Moving from Fees to Free, Creating a Literacy Strategy Teacher Resource Handbook through Faculty, Librarian, and Student Partnerships. In the literacy world, New York State has come up with some literacy briefs that are related to the science of reading. So basically, they've expanded on literacy research, moving from just a singular focus on phonics to a more expansive approach that includes like literacy research from the past 50 years. And so they've released some documents guiding teachers about how we can best develop reading and writing skills. And so we know that teachers today need free and innovative resources that will help them understand these New York State literacy briefs. So we wanted to work with our teachers. Our graduate students are actually teachers in the field. Some of them are substitute teachers. Some of them have their own classrooms. So we wanted to develop a resource that would address what New York State calls the Big Six skills and competencies. And we wanted to help those teachers be prepared to meet the needs of all the unique learners they have in their P6 classrooms. As Brockport is a big teacher ed institute, we kind of felt like this was a really important project for us to work on developing these free resources. So just to give those who are not in the literacy field a little bit of background knowledge, the literacy briefs focus on what they call the Big Six skills. And these are what we want our teachers to focus on. So, the Big Six skills and competencies that will support the development of efficient and effective readers and writers. So, they are oral language, phonological awareness, phonics, comprehension, fluency, and vocabulary. And so we thought that these would be kind of the main pillars that we have our students focus on when they created their own strategies to share through the OER resource. And so part of their assignment, our graduate course is very much where students have these scenarios. It's kind of loosely based off of project-based learning, where they have to kind of solve a problem and create like real resources. So their scenario was your principal was upset by the hacking of school computers and systems that resulted from downloading materials from a teacher website called Teachers Pay Teachers. He has asked literacy coaches to create a free, safe, and accessible resource of strategies to promote the development of the Big Six literacy skills and competencies. And so our students are going to act like literacy coaches and prepare this handbook. And so our next slide is going to show how we, a big problem with giving this assignment to students is how do we make sure that each student has their own strategy that we don't have any duplicates. And so, Logan, would you forward? Thank you. We just made up a Google Doc to solve that problem where students, for each of the Big Six, students had to select their own strategy that they would use to enhance this skill or competency. And then they signed up so that we had 40 students working on this. And so we have 40 different strategies for each of the Big Six, which is quite an amazing resource. For other teachers who might use this and our undergraduate students who will be using this.
There we go. Sorry, I muted myself. So the plan here is to create a SUNY Pressbook out of this. This is something that I've known about for a while. I've had my SUNY Create account for a while. I got one of the emails saying, hey, SUNY Create is going away, or it's not going away, it's going to a cost share model. And Brockport is not participating in that. But that same email also let me know that this SUNY Pressbook instance is staying. And so Pressbooks is, as it says, an easy to use writing software that lets you create a book in all the formats you need to publish. I have used Pressbooks in courses that I've adjuncted, and they're free and open, right? And it's super easy. And one of the things that Kathy and I were talking about when we were talking about the Big Six and the expanded definition of literacy is how important it is to get this content in front of teachers. And so while we could go with a few different resources, I think the SUNY Create Pressbooks will give us that balance of discoverability through search engine optimization in Google and the ease to publish. But it does take some work. So the first thing that we needed to do was to train our students on what OERs were, because we're asking them to create this free resource, but there's a lot that goes into it. So part of my job as the librarian for the course and sort of the publishing support was to find some resource that would explain OER, Creative Commons licensing, and all of that great stuff in a succinct manner. And I am a big fan of not reinventing the wheel. So I spent probably longer than it would have taken me to make a video looking around and seeing what videos existed out there. And I came across this great one from the Singapore Management University. I actually didn't realize that it was a university in Singapore until I was putting this presentation together because I had validated the content of the video, but never really looked in to see what SMU meant. It came from a library, and so I said this will probably be a good resource, and it is. This librarian talks through all of the major things we want our students to know about OER, and she does it in under 5 minutes. And for the graduate students that we have, under 5 minutes is really important, because if we were to assign them a 30-minute video on the importance of OER, they're not going to watch it. I mean, let's just be honest, right? If there's no actual assignment tied to it. So we started by showing them this video in Brightspace, and they didn't have a reflection on it, but they did have to do something with Creative Commons licensing that this video talks about. Another thing we did is we created a web page in Brightspace that sort of laid out the entire project. So it did start with that video, and then it talked about the role definitions, because Kathy and I needed to get our heads around, okay, who's doing what? How are we dividing this work up? How are we really working with the students? And what do the students need to be doing? What are their roles as authors here? So I created this chart where it had our names and our roles, and you can see that the students are authors. And their job is to create a high quality content that helps K-12 teachers integrate the Big Six into their classrooms. It's a nice, short, easy definition that we thought would help ground them constantly with it. And then Kathy is serving as the primary editor and reviewer of content for inclusion in the book. So everyone had to submit something, but they didn't have to submit it to the book. They all had to submit an assignment, and then they could make a choice on whether or not they want to publish it. The things that they are choosing to publish, we then serve in the role of editor for. Right. And so Kathy's the first editor. She may suggest slight revisions. I am a secondary editor, and I am also looking and doing the creation of the actual ebook. And, you know, as someone who has been trying to find faculty to work with on OER for a while, Kathy and I had this conversation, and I said, you know, you weren't in a spot yet where the factors had collided just right. And, you know, I thank Kathy so many times for like almost allowing me to come into her class and say, let's try this somewhat off the wall thing, right? And just see how it works. Let's see how we can take just a regular assignment in your class, and then I'll do the heavy lifting, which, secret, it's not really heavy lifting. It's going to be a lot of copying and pasting, right? But the content's already there. The students and authors have done all of the work for me. I just have to do like the easy formatting stuff. But that's my skill set. That's where it's easy for me to do that. And Kathy, I think you were sharing that it's just not something you have any interest in learning how to do right now, right? You want to see this happen, but it's having to do the creation of a book is just a step too much at this point.
The formatting's a nightmare for me.
Yeah.
So this is a great partnership.
Yeah. And Kathy and I have worked together for as long as you've been at Brockport. We go way back to me coming in with some crazy graduate research stories during her students' thesis projects. And so my job here is really going to be the paperwork, the administrative back end of all of that. But then also supporting those students in finding the resources to create their pages. So we did have some content in the course that allowed them to access ideas of journal articles, things like that. Do you want to talk about the template, Kathy?
Sure. So we just, we wanted students to have a little bit of a sample, you know, so they knew what to kind of expect. They knew what we were looking for. Students were able to make edits and changes to their template, but we wanted to show them that, you know, we wanted this resource to be easy for our undergraduate students to use and also teachers in the field to use. So, you know, we set it up with, you know, with bulleted research space points. We gave a sample of how to actually, you know, what the strategy looks like in action. And then, you know, this is just part of the template. There's another part where they have to put resources and things like that. But it gave them a really good idea of what should be included. And of course, their content will be totally different because it's based on their strategy. This is a turn and talk strategy. All teachers, it's one of the first strategies that teachers use in the classroom. We use it in our college classrooms as well. So I thought it would be a really easy example for them to see what that might look like in template form. So yeah, that's our template. And thank you, Logan. Logan created an editable Word document, and that seemed to work out really well for students.
Yeah, we just made the Word document and posted it into Brightspace, right? That they could download and fill out this template, and then they would upload it. We also covered the licensing. We asked students to apply a license. So while they did learn about the different Creative Commons, we decided to pick one as a suggested license because we thought it might be overwhelming to students if we said, just look at this list and pick. You know, so we were hoping that they would assign the Creative Commons by non-commercial and share alike. And so what we know is that that means that they have to give credit to the author. Only non-commercial uses of this work are permitted. And that was a specific choice we made. And we know that that's a little less open, but the education marketplace is full of predatory publishers that will take advantage of anything that's out there. And we really didn't want a company like Pearson to take this book and go create some secondary resource that they then turn around and charge districts thousands of dollars for. So that was really important to us. And that's why we also put the share alike on there so that anyone who creates anything as a remix of our content has to follow these same rules and make it free and open. We also educated students about just slapping a public domain license on it and say, you know, just free to use anything you want, the most open one. We did also give students the ability to assign no license. And this was really important because we didn't want to force students to create an OER. Some students said, I'm really not comfortable having my content out there yet. We don't know if that's just a confidence issue or if it's I don't want to do it, right? I don't want anything published. We did have one student reach out and say, I don't want my name on anything. Is there any way that I can, you know, I don't mind the content being published, but I don't want my name or my photo attached to it. Because as you saw in the template, it has a space for the teacher's photo. And so what we decided to do in that case was come up with a pseudonym. You know, there's nothing that says that it has to say that this is Dr. Olmsted's classroom or Miss Smith's classroom, right? And so I think we named that student. I was looking around and I saw something shiny and I'm like, how's Miss Sparkle or Miss Sprite or something like that, right? Let's just pick a fun name and we'll do that to protect student identities. Because to us, it's really about getting that content out there and we want students to have credit. So that if they are interviewing for a position, they can say, hey, look at this great thing I've already done that's been published. But if they don't want to do that, they don't need to, right? So we actually use the quiz feature in Brightspace to collect their responses to this. So they had a one question quiz that they had to type out which license they wanted. And I don't have the exact number, but it's like 72% assigned a Creative Commons license, right? And really one person mistakenly typed their name. So we're checking with that student just to see what happened. I think that they meant to assign a Creative Commons license, but we're going to confirm. So that number may actually be a little higher. A fair number did say none. And it was a little scary when I was going through and looking at the licenses because the first three students all picked none. And so I'm going through and I'm like, one, none, no problem. Two, none, third, none. I'm like, did something go wrong along the way? And no, by the time I got to the fourth student, licenses had been assigned. So there was an assignment as well for students to submit their handbook pages, just as they would in any other assignment. Just a regular old assignment space in Brightspace. And then we unleashed all of this and waited for the questions to come in. And I got one. And Kathy, did you get many? I don't remember us talking about you getting many. About
how to download the template. So they really got it. And I think overwhelmingly, I thought more people would be hesitant to give permission. And we had a really high number out of 40 students. I mean, we have a significant, our handbook will be really large
yeah.
by the time we publish it because we had so many student submissions. And I think making it an assignment that everyone has to do anyway is a really good way to situate it because, you know, they're doing the work anyway. And if they're happy with it and proud of it, a lot of them agreed to have it published. So I'm very excited. For the first time we're doing this, it's been a really positive experience.
Yeah. So I have a couple slides that just show the sort of the technical background of how I quickly got information out of Brightspace. And so collecting the licenses, we use that quiz feature, right? I was able to, and I've restricted it so you can't see any of the students' names, right? I just checked this little checkbox at the top of the list, I made sure I could see all students, and then I exported it to the CSV. And then that gave me an Excel file of the text that everyone put in. I didn't have to click through each one. I was able to just quickly get a spreadsheet of who assigned which licenses. And then I went over to the assignment and I found the download button there. Full disclosure, I did have to Google how to quickly get this information out of Brightspace because I couldn't remember from the Brightspace trainings, but I was able to do the same thing and hit download, and it gave me a zip file that every student had their own folder for their submissions. And so while Kathy probably thought I spent hours going through and downloading each one, right? This took me about 5 minutes. To get everything out of Brightspace. And then I literally just opened that spreadsheet and opened the list of folders and deleted the folders of the students that did not agree to submit their work. I then put those folders in a shared space. And that's where we are right now, is all of the content we need to review is up. And we will be going through and doing that review. And we'll be working with students to prepare their submissions, right? And so that is things like double checking usage permissions of images, because a student said, well, I'm not sure, I did just go to Google Images. So now we need to go look, right? And we may need to create some additional examples. You know, we may need to work with other groups. And I've started reaching out to a couple elementary teachers. I know Kathy has a network, and we have other teachers that I'm sure would be very willing to help us with student samples if we want to include more. So next steps.
Sorry, I had to unmute. We are very excited to use this. I also, in addition to teaching graduate students, I teach undergraduate students. And, you know, this is going to save them. We usually have students buy a reading strategies book and a writing strategies book, which, you know, together is probably about $100. And so now we've created this resource that's specific to New York State, which is so much more powerful than the resources that are out there right now that are not aligned to the New York State requirements. And so I can't wait to use this with my undergraduate students. And I know that the teachers in our graduate program will use it in their classroom. So that is really satisfying to know that it will be really useful. And so now Logan and I were talking like, oh my gosh, like how, now that we have this one resource, what are we going to do every semester? How can we really make this continue to be really meaningful? And so we're going to try out some variations of the Big Six. So connecting those Big Six skills and competencies to family literacy. Like, how can we create a resource that teachers can share and send ideas home for families to engage in those literacy skills and competencies in fun and creative ways as a way for us to connect school, home and school? And that's something that in our accreditation process, it always comes up in review that our teachers need more experience in, you know, connecting with families. So it helps us meet that goal as well. We talked about connecting the Big Six skills, making an OER handbook about play and how to use play more in the classroom, especially with younger students. And so that would be another semester. Also, we were thinking about how can we make a handbook specific to early childhood literacy development and the Big Six. So we've got some ideas for where we're going to be headed in the future, and they'll be really easy for us to implement because all we have to do is change the focus to, you know, family literacy to play, and we'll have the rest of the, you know, it seemed to work really pretty well. So I think we'll have the rest of the assignment stay the same, and we'll just change our focus.
Okay, and that is our final slide.
Does anyone have any questions? I'm not sure if I guess we could look in the chat.
Yeah, I don't see anything in the chat. And I always like to stop the screen sharing for the discussion part so that we can see each other. Oh, Mary Jo.
Hi, all. This is Mary Jo Orzik. This is not a not a question. It's just awesome that I have not heard this before. This is my first opportunity. I knew something wonderful was going on, and I kept hearing snippets of it. But this is my first time to actually hear the idea that this is a non-disposable a way of teaching things so that students are not just doing a one-off assignment, but that is going to be a continuing living document, I think is awesome. Giving students the opportunity to publish, I think is phenomenal. I love the idea that it's aligned to standards. The whole thing just it's such a lovely partnership between a librarian and faculty member. I'm very excited about this. This is probably, you made my day. This is just a lovely, lovely session, and keep up the good work. I can't wait to see how the rest of it develops.
Thank you. Yeah, it was so, it really was something that developed over just a few conversations as well. And I guess that's something I'd like to say is for those of you that are on the call that aren't the professor role, right? That you are the support role. Kathy was really easy to work with once I had the conversation with her about, I will take on all the stuff you don't want to do, right? But I don't have access to 40 graduate students to help develop content. And Kathy, you really ran with it. You did this awesome thing. And I didn't think at first we were going to do, you know, each of the 40 students was going to submit 6 documents. But then when we broke it down into what they were actually doing, a single handbook page isn't a lot of work for them, right? And we talked about that. We did talk about being a little nervous about what's going to happen when student 38 or 39 has to look at that Google Doc and pick some things. And I'm like, well, we'll cross that bridge when we get to it. And the bridge stayed intact, right? We didn't need any extra tools.
Yes. I think, you know, one of the reasons I love partnering with you, Logan, is your willingness to do all the things that I detest, like formatting and APA and computer related tasks. So this really was a great partnership. The students did a phenomenal job. And for me, as the professor, as the instructor, like the main point of everything that they learn in class is how can they apply it to their work as teachers? And this is, you know, pure application. This is what it looks like. You know, they got the opportunity to share what it would look like in my classroom. And, you know, pushing them to come up with 40 different strategies. We were nervous about that, as Logan mentioned, but Logan provided some great ways to help them search, again, you know, having that librarian expertise is really helpful. And they did. It pushed them to be creative. It pushed them to think of really cool ideas and to use resources that are out there and cite them appropriately and then look for the scholarship and the research that supports those ideas. How do they support comprehension? How does it support oral language development, things like that? So it's exciting. And the thought that we can keep doing it every semester and just, you know, tweak it slightly is really exciting as well.
I think we are out of time. But I think lunch is next, right? So I have a couple more minutes. Yeah, it says lunch break till 12:30. So if you want to ask Catherine.
Yeah, I just, you know, I teach in the literacy program at SUNY Potsdam and work with these graduate literacy candidates and always trying to think of a fresh way to approach that experience as a literacy leader, coaching kind of experience. And this is an interesting way to do that. And so now I'm thinking about, okay, how would I replicate it every year? And then what are creative ways we could use it? Like, we used to have a literacy conference every other year. And so in my mind, I'm thinking, well, we could have like a speed round and we could have these students, you know, get a few minutes to sort of blurb their strategy. And, you know, so I'm just thinking about how it helps us take things from abstract, as Mary Jo said, sort of disposable assignments into something that's actually useful, and how they go about sharing it. It's a great resource for undergrad coming up, right? But also how we can use it to connect with our teachers who are in the school as well. So it's exciting to hear something new.
Yeah, I know it's my hope that, you know, after we get this up and going and we see how it works with the undergrads, really making this available to the teachers of New York State, right? And it will, by virtue of being in SUNY Press Books, it'll be discoverable. But then doing that publicity work and getting our university behind, like slapping the SUNY Brockport logo on the front of it and saying, you know, a publication of SUNY Brockport, this is how we're giving it back. And then, you know, maybe down the future, we do work with other literacy programs, right? And maybe we work together in the future when we get to a stage where we need to keep this massive resource up to date. Throughout the system.
Updating it. And then also, you know, they've got poster sessions at the State Reading Association Conference, but what about just putting in a proposal and having a few of the authors come in to as a panel on that discussion. Yeah. You know, it would be great.
One of the great things about our literacy program, I'm not sure about Potsdam, but ours has moved to totally online. So now yeah. we have teachers from across New York State. And yeah. so I think that would help us with getting, you know, getting this out there. Because if mm-hmm. I'm a teacher who helped create the resource and I share it with the teachers in my building in Bayshore on Long Island, and someone is sharing yeah. it here in Batavia and, you know, outside of Buffalo. I mean, I hope that it will be a resource that's well used. But yeah, it's been fun, actually. It's been you know, kind of a real fun way to try something new and to, you know, make this available to people who need it for free.
Yep. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Great. Thanks, Logan and Kathy. I don't see anything else coming in here. I'm a Brockport alum, so it was great to hear this project and hear the presentation. Really good work. You're making Brockport proud. I'm going to go out and stop.